the charcuterie board of talk radio. It's me, Kate Delaney, here on ATN. Hope you had a great weekend. I know it was a tough one, a hot one, and also a tough one for people dealing with a wall of water because, of course, we had floods all over the Midwest, especially Iowa. Talk about that in a second. But first, at the top of this, got to give a shout out to a couple of people like Noah Lyles. All right, buddy, nailing the 100-meter final. So we're talking punching the ticket, going to Paris. If you like track and field, you'll be watching Noah for sure. And how about, yeah, sweet. That, bring that applause up. Noah deserves it. Woo! And then Christopher Bell won the USA Today 301st NASCAR Cup Series race. The delay was 2 hours because there was massive rain in New Hampshire where this race took place. And as a motor fan, I was thinking about this. It was Bell's second win in 5 career starts at New Hampshire. So now he's second in the NASCAR Cup standings. And do you know what a delay does to you? This race lasted 6 hours after a rain delay because it was 134 minutes and there were 14 cautions in this sucker. So it was really crazy to see how this went down. Drivers had to race on wet tires for the last 80 or so laps that you saw tons of spinouts and wrecks, and it was pretty tricky. So that's a very big one for him. So how about some applause for Mr. Bell? Oh, yeah. And then I was watching with the Hubs, you know, WNBA. He's asking me all these questions. We're watching it. And Angel Reese, LSU, she was the powerhouse at LSU, and she's the rival to Caitlin Clark. And she really powered the Sky past the Fever. It was a great game. We watched the tail end of it. 8 straight double-doubles for her. And the Fever loses to the Sky. Check this out. By 1 point, 88 to 87. This was good basketball. And Reese, as a rookie, 25 points in the win. And sets a record, by the way, and 16 boards. She was on fire. So how about some applause for Reese? Yeah. I'm a Caitlin Clark fan, but Angel, too. And watching the two of them, and she poo-pooed the rivalry at the end. Holly Rowe was asking her, interviewing at the end, what about this rivalry with Caitlin Clark? And she's like, you know, I don't know about all that. It's about winning this game and coming back. And that's what they did because they ended the game on a 31-15 run over the final 11 and change. And she was the big reason why. So who says rookies can't play? She is one heck of a player, too. And people know her and watch her. She's good for WNBA action as so well. All right, let's dive into what I think is horrific for so many people who find themselves in a very dark situation when an outrageous amount of folks are homeless in Iowa, all over Iowa, because of the massive floods that they've had. In fact, the governor, Kim Reynolds, did, of course, the aerial tour of so many of these spots in Iowa. They're just flat out soaked, wrecked, properties ruined, all of that. And this was her take afterwards.
I can tell you the devastation is severe and it's widespread. In almost every community impacted, the rivers crested several feet above record levels from the floods of 1993. In fact, we had 16 flood gauges that recorded historic levels. While we're still very early in the response, the projected damage is staggering, and at this time, it's estimated that at least 1,900 properties are impacted and hundreds have been destroyed, as well as a lot of ag property and ag land has also been impacted by the far-reaching flooding.
Yeah, you heard what she said. Rivers cresting above 1993 record levels, and the devastation is widespread. So, of course, it's a disaster declaration, no doubt about that. In fact, the Sioux Falls mayor is asking people there to avoid washing laundry, running dishwashers, doing anything else that would contribute unnecessary wastewater to the system. He even said, if you could avoid taking a shower today, that would be great. So it's bad. Remember, I was telling you about the New Mexico fires. The FBI is offering a reward of $10,000 for any kind of info leading to the conviction of the people that might have ignited the wildfires, because they don't know. Two people died. It destroyed hundreds of homes. It was nasty. And they're just tamping this out. In fact, people are going to be allowed back in Ruidoso on Monday. And they're even telling people, if you have asthma or other breathing issues, you might not be able to tolerate what you see in the air and what you ingest with the ash and the smoke and the soot and all that horrible stuff that is left behind. And then it's all about the heat and this insane heat wave. Baltimore, a high of 101 degrees on Saturday, breaks the record of 100 set back in 88. And it wasn't just Baltimore. It was up and down the East Coast. And there were all kinds of records that were set. Where I grew up, Philadelphia, 98 plus, setting records. Up that whole 95 quarter, it is absolutely terrible. Here is down and dirty what one woman had to say about what it feels like.
It's very hot. It's too hot.
It's too hot. It's too hot. What does it mean? It's all the things that we talk about. Hydrate, hydrate, hydrate. When you're part of that 100 million people under these heat advisories or warnings to beat the heat, there's not much more you can do than stay inside, be in cooling centers, triple digits. I mean, Arizona. Oh, my people listening in Tucson and in Phoenix, I feel you. I love me some Arizona, but 110? Wow. Utah, same thing. You Salt Lakers, you know, when it gets too high, you're just, I mean, you just got to douse yourself. You just got to take those precautions that seem simple, but all of a sudden you're feeling lightheaded and disoriented, and it's terrible. All right, Donald Trump didn't care about the heat. He was in Philly and talking to his crowd, and he was talking about, what do you think I should do for this upcoming big debate on Thursday?
Should I be tough and nasty and just say you're the worst president in history? Or should I be nice and calm and let him speak?
All right. What I'm going to be curious about is, and we're going to break it all down for you, of course, on Thursday, is how many people are going to watch it. So I want to know, we're going to take an unofficial poll, and I'm going to let you call my hotline this time around. So the America Tonight hotline, 813-413-5239, 813-413-5239. Are you saying, nah, I don't care, same old, same old, I know what I'm doing, I don't care what's being said? Are you going to watch the debate or not? Just leave that on the line. You going to watch or not? You know, last time, the Trump-Biden debate in 2020, more than 73 million people watched at least some of it, and it made it the third largest debate audience ever. The most watched debate, would you be surprised? First one between Hillary Clinton and Trump in 2016, 84 million viewers. Your thoughts coming up next. We're hitting the mailbag.
Let's see. If something costs less, but people are happier with it, that sounds like something to look into. And that is MediShare. Maybe you've heard switching to MediShare to pay for healthcare can save many families up to $500 a month. And that is huge. But it's also true that people are way more satisfied after making the switch, too. The member satisfaction rate for MediShare is double that of the typical health insurance plan. Double. MediShare works, too. It's been around for 30 years. Members have shared more than $5 billion of each other's bills. People love having telehealth and a huge nationwide PPO network. So, yeah, really, you can save a ton and like it better. Imagine being happy with how you're taking care of your health care. So if you're self-employed or part of the gig economy, or you just want a plan you're happy with, you can call right now. You'll get a price within 2 minutes. So see what you can save. This is a very, very smart use of 2 minutes. Here's the number you need. Call 855-SHARE-40. That's 855-SHARE-40. 855-SHARE-40.
Lisa Wolf here to tell you about our newest website for old-time radio lovers. It's 100radioshows.com. At this site, there are 5 old-time radio shows waiting for you to download free as our gift to you. And be sure to browse the additional 700 old-time radio shows available to you for 70% off by using the promo code RADIO at checkout. This is a limited-time offer, so log on to 100radioshows.com. That's 100radioshows.com.
At Hot Shot Secret, we share the science behind common diesel problems. For example,
stiction.
Engine oil can break down under extreme heat, leaving behind varnish, a carbon-based deposit that creates drag on the engine's moving parts. This sticky friction is stiction. Symptoms include a rough idle and the loss of fuel economy and performance. Hot Shot Secret Stiction Eliminator is formulated to be left in the engine. It works as you drive.
Stiction Eliminator is available at truck stops, Tractor Supply, O'Reilly's Auto Parts, and online at hotshotsecret.com.
Crime across the country is at an all-time high. It feels like even a family road trip is taking a risk. We don't want the feeling of being unprotected and vulnerable. We found GetCCL.com. GetCCL.com gave us the help we needed to apply for a legal concealed carry permit that's recognized in over half of the country. GetCCL.com simplifies the process to apply, and it's all online. We used their free qualification process to answer a few questions and applied for our permit right from home. Thanks to reciprocity laws between states, when you're issued a New Hampshire concealed carry permit, you can legally carry in any state that recognizes your New Hampshire permit. It only takes minutes to apply, so don't wait. Exercise your rights today. Ensure you're protecting your family at home and in other states. Have peace of mind. Apply today. Go to GetCCL.com. That's GetCCL.com. Go to GetCCL.com. Exercise your rights today. Go to GetCCL.com.
Now let's talk about the mail. Can we talk about the mail, please, Mac? I'm dying to talk about the mail with you all day, okay?
Let's dig in the mailbag. Dig in the mailbag.
Yeah, you think that's how Jake Tapper is going to feel, one of the CNN dudes that is doing the debate? Who knows? Do we care? Do we care how that all goes down? In a way, we do, because I'm very curious with no crowd, no audience, mics cut off when you're not speaking. I think it'll feel very strange. I'm just going to give you a quick example, and then we're going to your thoughts. I don't know if you've ever done this. I'm sure you have. I know this audience. Somebody dares you to do something. Somebody dared me to do stand-up. So I went to stand-up. I went to a popular comedy club. I got on the list and I did stand-up. And it was like a handful of minutes. It goes by so quickly. And what I realized too is I can't imagine standing there and there would be no reaction from the audience whatsoever. And then if I'm in the middle of telling a really good joke, because the others weren't working, I felt, and they cut me off, that'd be terrible. And they do cut people off, but there's an audience there. So, and I was looking to play off the audience. To me, in a debate scenario, because I've been to debates, all kinds of debates, you're looking to get that reaction. There's something about that reaction. So no reaction this time around, which I think is, Trump was saying that, like, pretty much, you know, what do you think? How should I be? Because there's going to be no reaction. All right, we got reaction here to something very sad. This is from Scott listening to us on KSL in Salt Lake City. And he says, Kate, very sad what is happening in Saudi Arabia to all these people who are making their pilgrimage, their annual pilgrimage. More than 1,300 people, I think, plus have died because of the heat there. It's got to be regrettable to be making this move to Mecca for them, for these pilgrims, and then to see what's happened. I wondered why they didn't call it off, and maybe they just feel like they can, and if you're ill, you just got to keep on rolling. It's such a good question, isn't it? So if you don't know what it is, it's what we're talking about here is the Hajj is what they call it, and it is an annual pilgrimage. And Mecca is the holy city that is central for Hajj pilgrims. And the temperatures were 125 degrees. So then you had unofficial pilgrimages, I guess, because Saudi Arabia, I didn't know this, requires each pilgrim to acquire one of the 1.8 million available licenses to legally cross, you know, have access to Mecca to be able to do that. The licenses can cost thousands of dollars, our dollars, U.S. dollars. Unlicensed pilgrims don't travel in organized tour buses with air conditioning or easy access to water and food supplies and all that kind of stuff. So the Saudis are saying, the Saudi government is saying, that the unauthorized nature of the trips have been a factor, and that's what the death toll, they believe, is what a lot of it's about. You know, people just say people are worshiping, they lose consciousness, and then they're dead. They're and then a white cloth is thrown over the top of them. Wow. So because of that, the announcement was made. The Egyptian government vowed to take back the licenses of 16 Hajj tourism companies involved in making illegal pilgrimage. So, I mean, that's what the deal is, supposedly. That's part of it, because they didn't have the license and they didn't know what they were doing. Yeah. All right, here's another one. This one is from Howard. And Howard says, Kate, long time no talk, but trust me, I've been listening. I think you probably remember me. I've called in the past for your Nail the Score. I can't wait till football season. It's so, so fun when you do that. I guess what I'm thinking is the whole thing with what's going on with sharks. I heard you talking about that the other day and what happened in Florida. And I'm wondering if we're going to see more of that. And is it have something to do with more than just what's going on with fish? I heard you talking about the fish and tarpon and where people were and all of that. You know what? Everybody's talking about the whole shark thing because so many people come down to the Carolinas where they've had attacks and come down to Florida. And it was Fort Walton where this happened. And the fact that you had the two teenage girls and then the one woman in her 40s, just a shocker. Because I think you think, well, if I'm on a sandbar or if I'm in water that's not too deep, would I really even be worried about it? It's not like I'm in the middle of by myself in the middle of the ocean, or we're just fell out of a boat and I'm in the middle of the ocean. And, you know, the answer is the time. I think some of it is the timing. I do believe it's the feeding. I've talked to people. We've had people on the show about that, that if there are the fish, the tarpon, or if you ever see giant schools of fish, they could be little fish, but schools of them, you don't want to be in the water for that because that's feeding. So why take the chance? Just get out of the water. I think the other concern is, Howard, besides the sharks, because I can't put myself in the shark's mind and say, well, what is it? We just had these attacks. I think it was the same shark. I don't know that, but I'm betting it was the same shark because of the time that happened. I think the other thing that is really scary, frankly, and a great thing to remind everyone about, if you are going someplace near a beach with family and there's rip currents and they can happen all over the place, please pay attention to that, because it was such a sad story. I think that was a terrible story, that you had the parents of six kids and their couple of their kids were in the water with them and they died because they were killed by a rip current. The husband was trying to help the wife and they died, and there were lifeguards on that beach and there were red flags up. And in North Carolina, it was terrible over the weekend. They had 150, this is what they were reporting, rip current rescues. They had an alligator scare, by the way, and they had a shark bite. They had a shark bite report. And this was at Carolina Beach is the name of it, you know, coming out of Sunset Beach in North Carolina. So there were all of those rescues, but there was a man that was sent to the hospital for a shark bite as well. And that was in Brunswick County, kind of near South Carolina, that South Carolina border there. So some crazy things just seem to be happening in a, just right in a row, weekend after weekend. And then there was an alligator that was under a car that was at a Mexican restaurant that scared people, that they, that's like another reminder, if it's the dark and you're in territory, brackish water, of course, and the parking lots or whatever are near some of these areas, there is always that possibility, but are people really looking for it? But the rip currents, oh, you just gotta, if you get caught in a rip current, you gotta go parallel and just swim parallel and wait till you can get out. You can't just try to take that head on. All right, this one is from Richard, and Richard says, yo, Kate, I can't wait till Thursday. I am kind of pumped about watching this presidential debate. I don't know what to expect, because I think it is kind of odd that there aren't going to be any people in the crowd to be watching this. And then also the fact of the cutoff of the mics and how would that work, I think could be interesting. And how does this all play out with this format? And will we learn anything that is earth-shattering or something that's unique or different? Or what? How does this all look? Yeah, how does this all look? That's what I say. I don't know, because there is a big difference. We haven't seen this with Trump or with Biden either, where there wasn't an audience for any of the debates they've been involved in. I'm going to squeeze this one in too. This one is from Larry. He's listening to us in New Orleans, and he says, oh, I've been listening to all the things that you talk about when it comes to airline travel, and I'm right there with you with the whole Boeing nonsense. It just seems they can't get anything right, which is too bad, because you know they have good engineers, and you know they do some things right, but it seems to be one problem after another. And after last week and what happened with the CEO, I would assume there's going to be all kinds of charges that are going to be brought against Boeing. Yeah, prosecutors are recommending that the Justice Department bring criminal charges against Boeing because they're saying that they violated a settlement related to the two fatal crashes. That's something even different that's been thrown into the pile. My, oh, my. You can always email me your thoughts, kate@katedelaneyradio.com. The name of the book is Quiet Fear, an autobiographical novel, a second edition, and this story is so powerful. Its author, Cynthia J. Giacchino, joins us to talk about the book, the road to writing it, the protagonist, all of that wrapped into one here on America Tonight with me, Kate Delaney. Cynthia, thanks so much for sharing your story.
Well, thank you for having me.
Let's talk about what the road was to writing this book. How tough was it to write this book? What made you write this book? How did that all unfold for you?
It began to unfold when I retired from a career of teaching. I believe that when you live through traumas and hard experiences, there's a reason. And I searched for that reason my whole life, and it always was in poetry or in writing. So I began writing when I retired. And it took me 6 years to complete the book. And it was a good time to write because I had been through a lot of therapy and I had a very large toolbox to work with. But it was hard. It was very difficult. I wrote every day except for Saturday and Sunday. And I did a lot of rewriting because my editor wanted me to write to show the story and not just tell it, which required me to rewrite it after about 3 years of writing. And I started rewriting to show the story. And that gives the reader a better image of not just what happened, but what happens to children and adults that go through traumas in their life with their family and their friends and their faith and their school. So, and then what inspired me, what really kicked me off is I moved out to Denver, Colorado to be near my family. And I went to a book club and they were listening to my story and they said, you better start writing it because you're getting old and your memory will go and then you won't remember anything. So I thought, you know, that's true. I better start writing here. I'm not a young chick anymore. And that actually really pushed me into the writing mode. I started studying and researching and moving forward.
You know, it's so interesting about your book. And as I said, and the way you describe it too, being able to show it, being able to have people, I think, really feel that. And you say that right in the beginning. I love it. You talk to the readers and you say, when I choose to free my secrets to the world after facing longtime fears, I had also hoped to open conversation and understanding amongst readers about children and adults who have fallen victim to the suffering of longtime injuries from sexual, emotional, or physical abuse. How does that feel for you? How freeing is that?
Is it freeing? I don't know if I would actually say it's freeing as much as it is a goal, a direction, a drive, a passion.
And that makes sense. And you wrap so much of this around Lily, as you say, and the family Lily was born into. So tell us more about what people can expect in the book.
Okay, so it's an autobiographical novel, which makes it like a memoir, but turned into a novel. And I did that basically because of your freedom. You have more freedom to show and to write if you do an autobiographical novel versus a memoir. And I was covering many decades of time. And that is hard to do in just a memoir. So I went to an autobiographical novel. And the character, the main character, is Lily, who is me. And Lily's family, which consists of two sisters and a brother, mom and dad. And we lived way out in the country of northern Michigan up into the Upper Peninsula. And we lived on a river. And so the story begins with Lily being older. She's in her early 30s and she is seeking help to raise her son, who she has recently had. And memories start triggering and coming back as she's raising her child, which is very common for women. They can go through a long period of time and then all of a sudden some trigger comes, and as much as we try to put them away in a nice little box, they sometimes fall forward and they open up and we are back being a child instead of the adult we need to be. So the book carries on from there. Lily opens up and takes you through her life and how she got to this point.
And so in the book, you do take us in a lot of different twists and turns. For you, was there anything that you uncovered that you think the listeners will completely maybe relate to or think, wow, I know somebody that could use this book. I know somebody that has those, what the title of your book is, Quiet Fear, which I assume is why you named it Quiet Fear.
Correct, because I was quiet for most of my life. I broke the silence, and we women really need to start breaking silence, no matter what age we are. And When I was writing it, I would say that one of the hardest things I had to go through was that I spent many years reconnecting with my parents, making a very healthy relationship when I was in my 40s and 50s. And it was hard to write the bad things, but they were true. And as hard as it was to write, it was also, it would show the reader that with time and hard work, when you break the silence, it is hard and it can damage the family. But with time and hard work and honesty, that family becomes stronger. And so in the last decade of my parents' life, we were a stronger family than we had ever been. So it was hard to go back and go through the hard times. But I knew the good times were going to come forward. So that was very important. And that's why also that it took me so long to write, because I wanted to be very truthful with it. And I wanted to write it so that it wasn't too detailed to not be able to read. And so I balanced it with psychology sessions and then my life story times.
So again, I want to
say, make sense?
It totally makes sense. And for everybody listening, I know it makes sense to all of you. And the name of the book is Quiet Fear, an autobiographical, easy for me to say, novel, second edition. And it's on Amazon and Barnes and Noble. It is so incredibly powerful, and you can get it in those places and wherever good books are sold. So you're talking about this, and I see it weave throughout the conversation. When somebody reads your book, what do you hope they take away from reading the book?
I would hope that when I read a book, I like to learn something. So when I wrote Quiet Fear, I wanted to do some teaching so that people understand emotionally what a child or a teenager or young adult, older woman is going through, such as, such as triggers, you know, how do they work? Panic and anxiety attacks, the issue of shame and guilt and anger. So those are addressed in the form of psychology. And I would like my readers to walk away knowing that they've learned a lot and they understand and are more aware of the effects of sexual assault in any form. And also to bring forth their new wisdom to others and to spread the word, to help open up discussions. That I think that would be just so important in our society, is to help women and men open up so that they can release that fear, that quiet fear that's just been riding on them. And we can do more to help those that are going through this. We need a lot of help, and I know it's hard, and but I would like that they walk away with some new learning, with some awareness and discussion, and to share with others. And as parents that read this story, I wrote it so to show so that you could see how a beautiful, healthy, happy child can turn out to be such a stress point in your life. And you don't know why. What's wrong with my child? You know, why are they so naughty? Why do they rebel on everything I say? And the whole point of communication and not keeping secrets.
Wow, perfect place, a beautiful place to end this. Cynthia J. Giacchino, thank you so much for Quiet Fear and for coming on the show.
Thank you, Kate. Bless you and stay well and safe.
You too.
Did you know that healthy arteries make a gas? Yes, actually, three known gases. Hi, I'm Dr. Mitch. And nitric oxide is a gas that's readily made all day long to keep our arteries open by relaxing the blood vessel walls. By doing this, our circulation is increased, bringing blood, oxygen, and nutrients to every part of your body. Both age and poor diet can lead to a loss of this precious gas, and in turn, blood pressure can go up, energy can go down, and you can get tingling in your hands and feet. Well, our product, Ultimate Nitric Oxide, can easily help fix this lack of nitric oxide. Go to TotalWellness.com. That's TotalWellness.com, where we are helping you to look good, feel good, and enjoy total wellness.
In today's troubled world, our USA Armed Forces stand ready to protect you, your family, and our American way of life. When veterans return to civilian life, they deserve your recognition and support. You can help put vets to work by donating your car, truck, or van to Patriotic Hearts. Your donation will directly support programs to help vets find jobs or even start their own business. Donate today for fast, free pickup of your vehicle, running or not. Operators are standing by to answer questions about making a tax-deductible vehicle donation. Find out how you can make a difference in the life of a United States veteran. Call 800-209-4580. For 24-hour response, call 800-209-4580. 800-209-4580. That's 800-209-4580.
Finding great candidates to hire can be like, well, trying to find a needle in a haystack. Sure, you can post your job to some job board, but then all you can do is hope the right person comes along, which is why you should try ZipRecruiter for free at ZipRecruiter.com/free. ZipRecruiter doesn't depend on candidates finding you. Its powerful technology identifies people with the right experience and actively invites them to apply to your job. You get qualified candidates fast. So, while other companies might deliver a lot of hay, ZipRecruiter finds you what you're looking for. The needle in the haystack.
4 out of 5 employers who post a job on ZipRecruiter get a quality candidate through the site within the first day. ZipRecruiter, the smartest way to hire. And right now, you can try ZipRecruiter for free. That's right, free. Just go to this exclusive web address, ZipRecruiter.com/free. That's ZipRecruiter.com/free. ZipRecruiter.com/free.
Here at the tail end of this hour, and we talk about rewinding. You know, last week was big because there was conversation. If we look at the G7 summit, there was a lot of conversation over that. Remember, President Biden flew to Italy while trailing former President Trump in most polls, and it was a day after his son Hunter was convicted on felony gun charges. So there was that as that went through, you know, the weekend. So I guess that was like more than 9 days ago when all that first unfolded. And then he went to the G7 summit, which was certainly last week. And then you had the White House cancel some pretty high level U.S.-Israeli meetings that on Iran that were scheduled for Thursday after the Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu released a video on Tuesday claiming the U.S. was withholding military aid. And so that was a big deal because a lot of the people around Biden were enraged by all of that. And the video did a lot of damage. So the Israeli officials were already en route to Washington when the meeting was canceled. So it's like, oh, well, turn the plane around. I guess we're going to have to turn around after all of this. There were some really wild things that are happening with the IDF, with the U.S. and U.S. support, We've now been going through this since October 7th. And this is, you know, there's even accusations that more than a year before the attack, Israel had a 40-page document detailing play-by-play exactly how Hamas would attack the southern border. Remember, the New York Times reported that last year. But Israel never took Hamas's plan seriously, assuming the military group would never get past Israel's defenses. And then, of course, we all saw what happened after that. The weekend often is about chillaxing and going to movies or watching sports or doing a myriad of other things. Unfortunately, sometimes what happens, I think, on the weekend, because all of us are running around crazed during the week, it becomes a long list of to-dos, things that you have to do to get ready for the following week. But you might have gone to the movies, you know, Inside Out 2 is a popular movie. And then there's a new one that came out that I think looks pretty interesting, and it's on my list to go and see this one. Austin Butler is in it, and also Jodie Comer's in it. I like her. Tom Hardy's in it. You may not know any of these names, but you probably know Austin. He played Elvis Presley. And the movie is called The Bike Riders. Check it out.
I've been thinking, I can't run this club forever. I built this for nothing. This is our family. You and me, kid.
From the beginning?
Yes, please.
It was the golden age of bike riders. And I never felt so out of place in all my life. That's when I saw him for the first time. It took my breath away.
I'm Benny.
5 weeks later, I married him. I thought I could change him, you know? Not to be different, but to be, I don't know, like he's wild.
Yeah, the projections for this movie in the for over the weekend, because it was in 2,600 plus theaters, that it would, and it had preview screenings, that it would probably get 8 to 10 million heading into the weekend. And the numbers aren't out yet for that. But I like what this is. I don't know. I like what this is about. And I was just thinking this morning when I was walking the dog that I was watching somebody just kind of speed down on their Harley, and I was thinking, it seems like an interesting movie, and it's gotten some decent ratings, and it's an indie deal, and it's about a Chicago motorcycle club that rumbles around the American Midwest in the 60s, which you could hear like a little dialogue there about that, kind of like an Avengers Now on the Bike sort of thing, and I don't know. It just seems like it would be entertaining. It seems like it would be entertaining. Like a, as it was described by someone, a love letter to the 60s biker gangs. I don't know. I like that idea. So, yeah. Before my time, but really interesting, I think. If you go back and you look at the whole culture of riding. And I saw that in Texas when I lived in Texas. Lufkin. I was at Lufkin for something. I saw just tons of riders, and we've had people on that have gone to the whole Sturgis thing and what that was like, that culmination of people from all over the place that come that descend on Sturgis. And I have two really good friends, two guy friends that are riders. They've ridden across the country and they completely swear by it. In this heat, I don't know that I'd want to ride across the country in this heat. I have to say that. You know, as we look at the upcoming week and we look at the week that was, there's no doubt, and I said it right at the top, the focus is going to be on the debate on Thursday. But there also is a hockey game, Lord Stanley's Cup. Is it going to go across the border to the Edmonton Oilers, or do the Florida Panthers win their first cup? And it's going to be in Florida. The puck will drop on the ice in Florida at 8 o'clock. So there will be a champion crowned in the great sport of stick and puck. And there's going to be more Olympic trials. And so that's getting exciting because we're getting closer to Paris. So who are going to be the Americans that represent? That's something else certainly to look for as well. And then the other thing is we're going into July. I mean, this is the tail end of June. And as we hop into next week, how many of you are extending maybe a little vacation because the 4th of July falls on a Thursday? So with it falling on a Thursday, do you have Friday off? Is it just Thursday, Friday, and your weekend? Or do you have Thursday off and then you have to go to work? That would be, you know, you go to these picnics and you're watching the fireworks and everything, and then the next day you got to get up and go to work. If you have that kind of job, but we live in a world that's like, it's not a ladder, right? I call it, it's not the ladder world. We live in a jungle gym world where hours are all over the place. Some people are working from home. Everything has completely changed with that. I know so many of you are third shifters that listen, but some of you aren't third shifters either. You have days where you work late. You have days where you work early. And I think that has changed. So habits have changed for a lot of people. And then there should be a cool down with the temperatures that are so high right now, where people are complaining about records being broken and they're sweltering away. It'll cool down a little bit. I mean, the start of summer, because that officially was the 21st, it was awful, right? It was before it was the official start of summer. And yes, it's hot in so many of these areas. And we know when the weather changes, that's summer. But these records that are being shattered, and we're talking about, you know, it feeling like 110 degrees and whatnot, that's a whole different thing. I think my favorite thing about the heat, when people talk about the heat, and because I've lived in all these different, I call it quadrants of the United States, quadrants. So I lived in Nevada, I lived in California, I grew up in the East, I lived in the South, the Southeast, Southwest, live in the Midwest, and it is different. There are different kinds of heat. When you're talking about the humidity, that's a whole different ball game than when you're in Nevada and the kind of heat that you deal with there and the heat that you deal, frankly, with in Arizona, but all equally dangerous. When you find yourself hiking, you don't have the right gear with you, or you're outside too long. I mean, you all get it. We all get it, and we all get it that it's hot. The good news is that it's cooling down a little bit, so it might feel a little better this week. Anyway, one can hope. Thanks so much to Daniel Kinzerski for his work on the technicals in this first hour, and all of you for listening. Remember, are you going to watch the debate on Thursday? Hit me up on the hotline, 813-413-5239. You can text me or leave a message, 813-413-5239. And a big shout out to Linda Gormley. We're going to miss you, Linda. What a lady. What an interesting influence on my family. We'll miss you. RIP. Make it count, everybody.